One of the first known American COVID-19 survivors to receive a double lung transplant is now recovering and speaking out about the experience. 28-year-old Mayra Ramirez received the lung transplant at Northwestern Medicine in Chicago. Now, after weeks of intensive care, she's making excellent progress and joins us now, along with the surgeon who performed the operation, Dr. Ankit Bharat. He is the chief thoracic surgery at Northwestern Medicine. So great to talk with both of you. First, Mayra, let me start with you. We're so happy to know you are recovering. I understand you got sick in April, you got the transplant in June, and now finally, you're back home. I can only imagine what a crazy and scary journey this has been for you. Can you tell us about your battle with the virus, what happened, and what your recovery process has been like?
Well, I was working from home. I wasn't going out anywhere. I was taking precautions. I wasn't even walking my dog. On April 26th, I went to the emergency room. Everything happened so quickly. They took my vitals. My oxygen pool was very low. They were rushing me to change. Within 10 minutes, I only had a couple of minutes to contact my family to let them know that I was to be intubated. I was asked to have someone appointed as a designated person to make medical decisions for me. So I appointed my mother and my eldest sister. After that, all I remember was being put to sleep as I was being intubated, and then 6 weeks of complete nightmares. It's hard to distinguish what was reality and what actually happened. Some of the nightmares consisted a lot of drowning, and I attribute that to not being able to breathe and struggling to breathe. During that time, in Spanish, the word ventilator means like ventilador, like a fan. I didn't realize the severity of the situation. To me, a fan just means like they're going to, you know, help me breathe, give me some air, and I would be okay. So I was anticipating maybe at the most a 3-day stay, not 6 weeks on the vent as I ended up being on. And my family was called. They all live in North Carolina. I was with my boyfriend at the time. He's the one that dropped me off at the emergency room and was there every day, checking in on me. But other than that, my family really was in the dark about everything. They would get phone calls daily to see how I was doing. And then one day they were told that I wasn't going to make it past the night and to, you know, make the decision whether or not they wanted to fly up to say goodbye. Because before this, due to COVID-19 restrictions, the hospital wasn't allowing family members. So I wasn't, or anyone at all. Oh, so I wasn't able to hold them or see them, or they weren't able to see. So that night, my family took the first flight out of, they're from Clinton, North Carolina, where I am as well, but they took the first flight out of North Carolina to come see me. Thankfully, I was able to get stabilized. So by the time they got here, they were explained the option of lung transplantation because my lungs were, irreversibly damaged. And it was a last option for me. There wasn't anything else that they could do. My other organs were starting to fail as well. As a result of my lungs failing. And, 48 hours later, I received my lung transplant on June 5th. I had no idea that I had received a lung transplant. I just know I was in the hospital. Right. I looked at myself. I couldn't recognize my own body. I couldn't talk. I could barely lift a finger. I couldn't move. I was in a lot of pain. I was very confused. I was very thirsty. All I could think about was that I wanted water. I couldn't process. My mind didn't have the ability to, I think, because of the sedation. I lost a lot of cognitive abilities as well as physical abilities.
And yet, Mayra, you to hear that and to see you right now and the way you're articulating exactly what happened, you're painting this vivid image. It's incredible to see how strong and what you look like today, given how sick you were. One of your doctors told us for many days you were the sickest person in their COVID ICU and possibly in the entire hospital, and you had hundreds of people who were helping to take care of you. Doctor, let me turn to you. In your estimation, what would have happened if she had not received this transplant?
Anna, so she would not be alive today. You know, there were many times during the course that she had multiple complications from COVID and the virus, and the secondary complications from the virus also, even after she cleared the virus. So without the transplant, she would not have made it. As Mayra described, you know, her other organs were starting to fail. She had developed infections from other pretty aggressive bacteria, so she really needed this.
What made her a good candidate for the procedure?
Well, so she, youth was on her side. And so despite the complications, we thought she was young and otherwise healthy. You know, she had cleared the virus from her system from the best tests we have available. We were able to establish that. Hmm. And so I would say, you know, those were the two big things, you know, her youth, her, the fact that she was otherwise healthy, and then she had cleared the virus from the system.
And Mayra, you know, how are you feeling today? And what is your message to people in this country who may not be taking this virus seriously?
I'm still in a lot of pain. I'm very weak. I'm working on my endurance and strength. I'm still struggling to breathe and learning how to use my new lungs. I feel that my message to people is to understand that this is not a hoax. This virus is real. It happened to me. It can happen to them. I know some people are asymptomatic. They should still be careful for those and be considerate of those more vulnerable around them. Also, I want other centers to understand that lung transplantation is an option for terminally ill COVID patients. And I want to be an example of that.